What is up, Pitt fans? Thank you so much for tuning in to Inside the Panthers on YouTube. My name is Stephen Thompson, here with my partner, Dom Campbell, and it has been a wild week for the Pitt Panthers, and not in a good way. The Panthers saw three players leave through the transfer portal, immediately after the end of spring ball. Some of them were messier than others, some of them a lot more unexpected than others, but either way, defensive end Dayon Hayes, linebacker Solomon DeShields, and quarterback Christian Veilleux, all guys who started last year at certain points and to varying degrees for the Panthers, are on their way out of the program. And we're going to break down what we think, what we saw, what we heard, and where the Panthers go from here after losing three pretty big names from their 2024 roster. Let's start with Veilleux for a second here, Dom. I feel like this was one that was pretty straightforward. Definitely the least surprising transfer, I'd say. Of the spring and of this week, I'll ask you, I guess, were you surprised at all that Veilleux opted to go find a new school, and why or why not?
No, I wasn't surprised, Stephen. I think this has been coming for some time now. I think at spring ball, we were hearing more about Eli Holstein, obviously the Alabama transfer who redshirted last year, and far more than we do Christian Veilleux. And obviously Christian started last year. So to have, obviously, Yarnell is a starter. That was pretty obvious. And then Holstein next. I mean, Bayer's a third quarterback. And for him, I don't think he wanted to be third on that depth chart. I don't blame him. But realistically, that's just where the coaching staff and the players saw him. I mean, the gold team for the spring game drafted Holstein over Bayer. That does say something. And even Pat Narduzzi was saying that Bayer turned the ball, well, not that Bayer necessarily, but he liked that Holstein didn't turn the ball over. And as we know, last year, Veilleux had troubles turning the ball over, specifically against Notre Dame, where he threw four interceptions. And then against Syracuse, while they were up at the half, twice on handoffs, he turned the ball over, which led to Syracuse scores and eventually the loss at Yankee Stadium in November. Those are things. And then he eventually lost his starting job, and Yarnell would take on the starting position for those final two games. So really, I'm not surprised to see him go. He has talent, but he was not able to show that last year at Pitt. Aside from being really solid in the Louisville game, and then his probably a better game he played was against Wake Forest, but obviously so many Pitt fans will remember the slide in which prior to getting to the first down marker, he slid, but because of the Kenny Pickett rule, where if you try to quote-unquote fake a slide, you are marked down, the referees marked him down prior to that first down marker, which allowed which made a fourth down instead of first down, and then Junko, terrible punt, and then you know how it all goes, and one of the worst losses in recent memory. Only really, it's just that the season was so bad that lost, and most people aren't going to remember it as badly as some of the other losses Pitt suffered. But I mean, yeah, like just those moments in which, you know, he started off well and things just started to go bad. I think heading into spring, those things still go on, and he probably just needs a new start. And I'm glad to see him go into the portal and hopefully try to revamp his career somewhere else.
Yeah, man. I mean, it was such a weird five games that he started. It starts off with the Louisville game, and he looks incredible. You know, he's throwing the ball all over the field. They're hitting deep shots. They upset a top 15 team. And then, you know, you go to Notre Dame, and he looks the way he did. You go to Wake Forest, and that was just kind of a comedy of errors in a way that I find it hard to even blame Veilleux for. Like, that was just like three or four freak plays in a row that really undid the Panthers there. But you do make an interesting point about one of the worst losses in recent memory, because there's some bad losses up there, especially last year. I agree with you. I don't think this was surprising at all. I mean, I'd even go back to when he was benched last season. That's when I think the kind of gear started turning about, in my head at least, about, okay, this could be a guy who's on his way out at a certain point over the offseason. I thought, you know, if it was going to happen, it could have been earlier. I feel like in, you know, December or even prior to spring ball, we got Pat Narduzzi and Cade Bell declaring that Nate Yarnell was QB1. They were going to walk into spring ball as QB1. And then we got the confirmation after the spring game that Narduzzi still considers Yarnell QB1. I mean, it's pretty plain to see why. We heard Narduzzi's comments about Yarnell and Holstein both hanging on to the ball a little bit better than Veilleux was. And then you watch the spring game, Veilleux goes 0-for-6 in his two series played, while Yarnell and Holstein find some really positive things to show on the field. So I agree. not really that surprising at all. The one thing is I'm pretty interested to see where he goes next. You know, I think, like you said, this is a guy who obviously has a ton of arm talent. Maybe that stuff needs to get refined a little bit, but you don't beat a top 15 team in your first start on accident. I think there is clearly something there. So I'm kind of assuming he still goes Power Five. I think there's going to be a school that's interested in him. He's a grad transfer, but has 2 years of eligibility left. So I think there's still a little bit of meat on that bone. I don't know if you feel the same way, but I think we're going to still see Christian Veilleux at his third Power Five school by the time it's all said and done.
I mean, he has a shot. As we said, he does have the talent. I mean, watching him throw the ball during Pitt Pro Day to wide receivers like Bob Means and stuff and Malcolm Epps, and like, wow, the arm talent's there, but like, he just seems in games at times, he makes poor decisions, and like turning the ball over is something that no coach wants, specifically not a defensive-minded coach like Narduzzi. So like, he'd probably need a head coach that would be willing to give him a chance to maneuver a little bit and maybe make a few mistakes. But if that's at the Power Five, then I mean, I think it's deserved. He's got the talent, but I would be surprised maybe to see him go a little lower depending on what opportunities he's given over these next few months in the transfer portal.
Yeah. And I mean, I don't think he's going to, you know, Georgia or anything, but I do think that he has a chance at kind of a lower end ACC, Big Ten, or even Big 12. I think, like you said, like, I don't think if he goes Group of Five that he's dropping any further than the American or the Mountain West. Like, I think he'll still stay in that kind of upper echelon of the Group of Five at least, but who knows? We'll see. I haven't seen any reports about who's contacted him or where he's visiting or what kind of schools he's looking at. So I'm real interested to see where he does end up. We're going to move on to the next transfer, the next guy on our list. And this one is a little more complicated. This one requires a little bit of a longer conversation. It was the talk of Pittsburgh Twitter for at least a night. A couple nights, it really riled up the Pitt fan base. Dayon Hayes announcing that he would enter the transfer portal got people upset enough. It seemed to kind of come out of nowhere. This was a guy who seemed like he was poised to be the best defensive end on this Pitt team this year. He was probably the best defensive end on the team last year. The production wasn't exactly what you wanted, but that's true for the entire front seven, the entire defensive line. It was a pretty down year for them in terms of, you know, getting sacks, getting TFLs, being disruptive on quarterbacks, and Hayes was certainly not immune to that. But did you see this one coming? Because I know for this one, I know Hayes transferring was completely out of left field for me.
Yeah, very surprising. I don't think I expected this. I mean, we spoke to him, I think, last week or the week prior at for interviews at the facility, and he seemed like really excited to be a part of the Pitt team going forward in his final season. And he obviously on Twitter a lot, you know, posting how much he's excited to play this season. So to see him enter the transfer portal was somewhat of a shock. I just didn't understand it because, you know, this is a guy that's a starter, has all the playing time, local guy, played for Westinghouse, you know, has basically the reins at defensive line to do what he needs to do, obviously at the end. But yeah, I was very surprised. I did not see this coming at all, Stephen.
Yeah, I was really, really surprised as well. It didn't really make a whole lot of sense to me. I mean, look, I get it. He lost his position coach and everything, and that's really tough. And just the timing of when he did lose his position coach was weird as well, because, you know, Charlie Partridge leaves after the transfer portal closes in the winter. He doesn't get another chance to transfer until the spring. So I guess that in and of itself isn't that surprising. The timing of it isn't that surprising. I think it's interesting the way that he talked, like you said. Like, when we spoke to him, I mean, he had a lot to say about being a leader on the defensive line, being a guy who can bring these younger guys along. And it seemed like he was someone who, you know, grew up a Pitt fan, grew up in the area. Like you said, went to high school in this city. It seemed like he had a ton of pride in the University of Pittsburgh and in the Pitt football team. So it's just that much more shocking when a move like this becomes so sudden and happens so quickly. I mean, I certainly didn't expect it, and I certainly did not expect what came afterwards. I mean, like I said, the decision to transfer was surprising enough, and it had Pitt fans upset. It had everyone guessing, oh, someone throwing him an NIL bag. Like, are we going to be able to compete with that? What kind of opportunities aren't we giving him here? And then Chris Carter, the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette, drops a pretty big bombshell later that night, an interview with Dayon Hayes saying, you know, it just, he asked Dayon about, you know, why he wanted to leave and what his reasoning behind transferring was. And Hayes gave a pretty blunt answer. And I'll read you the quote that he gave right now. Quote, "It's just that I don't believe that we can win now. I believe we were going to win games, but I believe we are in a developmental stage, and I just can't do that right now." That stinks, man. I can't imagine there was a player in the facility, a coach in the facility, or a fan who saw that and took it very well. It was shocking. It was pretty stunning. As soon as I saw the headline and saw the first kind of excerpt on the quote that came out on Twitter, I think my jaw was on the floor for a few minutes. But Dom, what was your first reaction to seeing these comments from Hayes the night that he decided to transfer?
Pretty stunned, I guess. We're not used to seeing college football players be so blunt about things. We generally we can't just call these guys up on our own and be like, "Hey, what's up, man? How you doing?" And like all this stuff where, you know, maybe in the pro level, you can have a bit more of a professional relationship. But for college, like, we have to go through a lot of different ways to get and talk to players. So when a player's just like, "Yep, I just didn't like the program. I just don't like where the program's going." It's a bit weird. It's like, whoa, what's going on? And that's going to cause a lot of alarm bells to go off, not just at Pitt, but I mean, for fans, donors. I mean, it's a big deal. I mean, when someone's like, "Yeah, the football program's going nowhere. I don't want to be here." And that's your starting defensive end. And he's like, "I'm leaving." Like, that's not a good look. I'm sorry. But at the same time, I guess if you're a player on the team, you can use that as motivation to be like, "Well, he's wrong. We could be a really good team." And K Bell can be like, "Well, it's my first season, but I can show that people that this not just works at the FCS level, but also the Power Five and the ACC." So you do have ways to use this motivation. But I think at the same time, it stings because local guy basically is going on record saying this team is not good. And that's not fun for any fan or anyone else to look at if you're in the program or outside of it and a supporter of it.
Yeah, I think you hit on a couple interesting things there. First of all, I mean, the idea that a player would be this blunt with us, I mean, you've covered Pitt for a while. I've covered Pitt for a while. Like, Pitt players in particular, I feel like, are never this blunt and upfront with you about really anything. You know, these are guys who, you know, even before they get to Pitt, they are guys who have gone through kind of the media ringer a little bit. They've had microphones and cameras in their face before. And once you get to Pitt, you kind of go through a little bit of training. I mean, it's much closer to being a pro than, you know, a college athlete would have been, you know, a few years ago, or even about a decade ago. But these guys get trained to, you know, not really give substantive answers and to not peel the curtain back a whole lot. And Hayes did anything but that. I mean, he posted the screenshots of his conversations with Chris Carter from the Post Gazette, and you know, there's no really misinterpreting it. There's no way around it. I mean, Hayes said what he said, and he meant it. And it was the first thing on his mind when he was asked, "Why did you transfer? What were your reasons for it?" So that's really rare. I think you hit on another thing that I forgot to mention, and that's what you know, Carter's kind of further reporting down in that story, which was first of all, that Alliance 412, the NIL collective, had offered A's, and I'm quoting here, "One of the highest paying NIL deals on the team for the 2024 season." It was a sign that they valued him, that they believed that he would be one of the best players on this team coming into the season. And Hayes, who, again, I'm you know, citing from Chris Peek of Panther Lair, said on his podcast yesterday that Hayes renegotiated his NIL deal a couple of times in December as part of the deal for him returning to school. And it seemed like the money still wasn't enough to keep him in Pittsburgh. Then Hayes is also voicing concerns about the offense that's being run by Cade Bell, new offensive coordinator, and the state of the offense as it was last season, which I think kind of goes hand in hand with his comments about not thinking that the team really had direction or had a future this season, had a future that involved winning. Like you said, I mean, this is devastating stuff. I mean, this is not fun to hear. It's not necessarily going to sink this program, but man, it is not something not something enjoyable to have out there. Like you said, just this is supposed to be one of your best players, one of your proudest, most ardent supporters. And as soon as he's not with the program anymore, he's going behind your back and leaking to the media that he doesn't have any confidence in this team, which is something that you're maybe able to read between the lines, but you just never see anyone say something this explicit. I mean, for as much hate as Jordan Addison got, he never let a bad word about Pitt come out of his mouth. You know, same thing for Bengali Kamara, same thing for DeAndre Jules. Like, this just doesn't happen for guys who transfer from Pitt. And for it to be Hayes, of all people, is really, really stunning. I will also say, I mean, Dayon Hayes had 4 sacks last season. Like, look, I mean, Pitt had a lot of things go wrong last year. There were a lot of units on this team that weren't very good. Hayes was part of that, you know? Like, led the team in tackles for loss with 10.5. That's awesome. But this is a fifth-year senior going into his fifth year this year. Was in his fourth year last year and had never quite lived up to the talent level that everyone knew he had. And every year it was just, yeah, we need to see a little bit more from Dayon. He needs to be more consistent, needs to do this, needs to do that. So I think that's the other thing that really stings, is to have a guy who never really quite realized his potential come out and say that this program wasn't good enough for him. I think that's the most, I think that's the thing that would upset me the most if I was a Pitt player or coach, is that this guy who didn't do a whole lot for us over the past 4 years was big time in us, you know, that like that made it seem like he was too good for us when we were trying to support him and bring him along and put a lot of faith into him. So I think that was really what rubbed a lot of people the wrong way at the end of the day, when they got to kind of digest it and think about it a little bit more. And so, you know, that's that. I mean, it is what it is. I mean, he said what he said. That stuff is out there and it's always going to live there. Whether it's bulletin board material, whether it's just something that they try to brush off, it is out there and it's going to exist forever. But now that the Panthers have to move on, how do they kind of move on? I mean, Dayon Hayes was, like I said, I mean, the production wasn't always there, but he was supposed to be one of the better players on a pretty thin defensive line rotation. So in your mind, where do the Panthers go from here? How do they go about replacing Hayes?
You're not only just replacing Hayes, but we have to remember that Sam Okunlola left as well, and he was a bright star on that defensive line, specifically at the end. Him and Dayon Hayes was to lead this team this season, and both are gone. And I mean, for Hayes, it is tough that he leaves, but he only has one more season of eligibility. With someone like Okunlola, it's like, well, that was 3 years we could have had, or 2-3 years, and it's like, now they're gone. But so for Pitt, I mean, they have a few young guys on the roster. I'm trying to think of some guys, but like Sincere Edwards is someone that stands out to me. I think that too. Dayon Hayes was like, yeah, he's really good. He's someone that Pitt fans have got to watch out for. And Pitt flipped him from UCF. Well, Charlie Partridge did. But, I mean, like, he's a guy that really looks like he could shine as a true freshman. That's a really – for Pitt, which generally redshirts almost all their freshmen, would be a big deal for him. Jimmy Scott's probably another guy I'm looking at as well, maybe younger, that can shine the defensive end. Yeah, those two guys for me, there really aren't a ton of guys left at defensive end. I mean, you have Bam Brima, who's a 6th year, but he's never produced really at a high level. Nate Temple's injured. So really, I think Edwards and Jimmy Scott are going to have a lot of opportunities going forward for this Pitt program.
I think you're absolutely right. I mean, Edwards was a guy who seemed like he was ready to be on the two deep, had momentum heading towards him being on the two deep by the time fall training camp started. So I think he's absolutely an option. Is he... You know, would he have been a starter if Hayes was there, or if there's even another veteran there? Probably not, but it seems like the Panthers are going to have to rely on him. Jimmy Scott seems like another guy who, I think he was kind of behind Nate Matlack and Hayes, obviously, on the depth chart, but a guy that a little bit older and after, I think, a couple years in the Pitt defense, so he's rising a little bit. Everyone's just kind of getting bumped up a spot, but the only other, I don't know, real name that I think you can really think about is David Ojegbe, I believe. The Clemson transfer. I mean, he's at least got a year of college football under his belt, even if he redshirted for the Tigers last year. So, I mean, those are the names that I'm watching. I don't think any of them are going to be as good as Hayes. I think that's pretty plain to see. I mean, as much as I touched on the, you know, Hayes hadn't done a whole lot over the course of his career, he still was the most talented guy on this defensive line, the guy that they were going to rely heavy on. Anyone you throw in there, you know, barring some miracle that you pull out of the transfer portal, which I think they're going to have to hit pretty hard as well to at least get one guy, like at least get bodies to fill in the defensive end spot. You're going to see a pretty significant step back from where, you know, you might've imagined the defensive line and the defensive end spot could be this year. I think, you know, I was kind of counting on some improvements from them, especially you know, from last year, which was an abnormally down year. But, you know, we'll see. I mean, this changes the calculus quite a bit. We're moving on a little bit to the last of our kind of three football transfers that we've got to touch on. The next one is Solomon DeShields, linebacker. This one, at least to me, was a really huge surprise. I mean, this was one of the last guys that I thought would ever transfer from Pitt. And it turns out that he is moving on as well. No messy exit, but this is still a huge loss for the Panthers nonetheless. What did you make of DeShields moving on?
Yeah, maybe even more surprising than Hayes. I mean, DeShields had a pretty solid season last year. I think the only game – we played in every game, but the only game to start was Wake Forest. I think he was injured on the opening kickoff, if I'm not mistaken.
Yep.
So every other game he was there at star linebacker, which is a big part of the defense. I mean, it's almost functioned like an outside linebacker, but still a crucial part of the other guys as well. So a really solid player, someone that I thought could even burgeon into maybe a star, like, you know, figuratively a star this season. But no, he'll be gone too. And that's two starters from your defense that are gone from last season. And people will say, well, 3-9. And I would agree. You probably don't want to lose your starters from, especially as a linebacker. I thought the linebackers were fine last year for the most part. So you don't want to lose like your starting linebackers heading into this season. So I'm a bit shocked, but with the way college football works nowadays, anything's fair game for the most part.
Yeah. I mean, you make a good point. I think anything is possible in college football, but this one wasn't even close to being on my radar. I thought DeShields was not just, you know, going to be a starting linebacker. I mean, he had a career year last year. I think he led the team in sacks, was up there in terms of tackles for loss. He was one of the most disruptive guys on the team. And you have to assume another year in the system, another year of, you know, another year of work, another year of growth and everything should have served him pretty well. And it was just a guy like, I think you're right. It was more surprising than Hayes, and in part because he had just, you know, obviously anyone can speak highly of any program. Words don't mean a whole lot, especially when, you know, actions can be turned on their head. But, you know, I think at some point you're listening to Solomon DeShields talk about Pitt, and you just can't imagine this guy ever leaving. It seemed like one of those guys who was just, you know, kind of married to the program, had found his home, was really comfortable, and was having some success when he stepped into a starting role. So to that end, it's like, why leave, you know? And I think that was the most surprising thing. I mean, especially after, you know, DeShields, I think, announced his transfer yesterday. And a week before, he gave this quote. I'll read it out to you. Quote, "I've always trusted Pitt from the day I signed, honestly. The coaches that we've got on defense, I trust them. I've got all love for those guys. They taught me a lot. And that's like, it's hard to describe. Those are like NFL coaches. I could tell because they're nitpicking on everything from your alignment to your assignment. They're grading me on that, and they're trying to get you better on everything that you do." So, I mean, this was a guy who at least at one point very recently said that he believed in these coaches and their ability to develop him as an NFL player and to get him where he wanted to go. I mean, that's very different from Hayes, who just flat out said, "I think this team stinks." It was maybe a little kinder of an exit, but at the end of the day, I think it says something about what DeShields thought about Pitt. And it's not like he had guys in front of him. This guy was going to be a bona fide starter. This one didn't make a whole lot of sense to me other than, I don't know, there's got to be something we don't know about something that was promised to him from another school. Someone was in his ear telling him something either about Pitt or about other opportunities that he might have. I feel like that's the only explanation in this one. There was no coaching change. There's no starters in front of him. There's no injury. There's no, you know, public dispute with it. Like, I just, this all, the reasons why DeShields wants to transfer, I feel like, are not really going to become public for a while, if they do ever become public at all, which I think makes this one most confusing. I will say though, and I don't know what you think about this, this is very different from losing Hayes in terms of the linebacker position is much better stocked, I think, with starting caliber talent than it is at the defensive end spot. I mean, from Rasheem Biles to Kyle Lewis, Braylon Lovelace, you know, Braden George, pretty cemented as that Mike linebacker spot. But we haven't even talked about Key Thompson, transfer from Ohio, who hasn't been able to practice this spring. But I think an experienced guy like that is definitely going to play for them this year once he gets healthy. So I look at this and I'm pretty optimistic about what the linebacker position can do even without DeShields. And I'm not sure if you feel the same way.
Yeah, I'd say compared to the defensive end specifically and also the D-line as a whole, I would say the linebackers are a bit better in a bit better position than the defensive line is. So, yeah, I think Kyle Lewis, especially because he was behind DeShields at that star linebacker, I think he's someone that really could come out this year and be one of those guys that makes a name for himself. Yeah, I mean, they had three guys last year, true freshmen that played, Rasheem Biles, as you mentioned, Jordan Bass as well, and Braylon Lovelace, Whitfield kid. So they have some real talent at that linebacker position, and I'm excited to see what Key Thompson can do. I mean, he's been around forever, it seems, and he started at Ohio, just came the season. Yeah, so I think, and also Brandon George isn't hurt to have a veteran like him in the starting lineup. So, yeah, I think the linebacker should be fine, although you don't want to see, you know, obviously right. Kamara left, he was a starter, and now another starter is gone. So two or three starting linebackers are out of the program. Not really a great offseason overall for the defense, it seems.
No, not really. But, you know, like I said, I mean, linebacker, if there was a position where you were going to lose a starter at, linebacker feels like the easiest one to brace for a loss there. You know, as we kind of talk about, you know, the kind of the ramifications of DeShields' transfer, I want to look kind of bigger picture. I mean, it's obviously a concerning week losing two starters from your defense. I mean, to you, does this say anything in particular about the program as a whole? I mean, are you concerned about the direction that this team is headed? Do you think that Pat Narduzzi is his seat starting to get a little bit hotter? I mean, what do you make of kind of the 30,000 foot view of losing to Shields and Hayes in the same week?
I guess a few points. I would say, obviously, not good to be losing your starters. And even if, like, maybe this team wasn't great last year, like I said, you don't want to lose your starters, especially not the spring ball when it seems like those were the guys that are going to stay. But it also says that the transfer portal never ends. I mean, even now we're seeing tons of guys from so many different programs leave. Like, Pitt's not the only team with transfers, man. Like, every program, good to bad, is losing guys. Coaching change, no coaching change. Obviously, that will exacerbate changes for transfers especially, but it happens everywhere. So I guess if you're a Pitt fan, you're looking at, like, well, one, is this team going to be good this year? They were 3-9 last year, which is unacceptable for Pitt. I mean, no one's expecting Pitt to be a perennial undefeated team, national champion. Who are expecting a competitive team that wins at least probably around 8 games? And that's what they've done for a good portion under Narduzzi's tenure. So can they keep doing that? And that's really something Narduzzi has to figure out. And with the change in the offense, that's something that we'll have to see going forward. But another thing is looking at Alliance 412. I mean, these two guys were apparently quote unquote signed by Alliance 412. They made graphics that said, like, they're coming back, and, well, they're not back. They're gone. So as a fan, if you're donating to Alliance 412, if you're a big-time donor, what does this say? And if you're Alliance 412, what do you tell the fans? Do you just brush this off and don't address it? Or is it something you try to be like, well, we tried our best. We did give them – we did what we could in terms of keeping them around, but it just seems like it didn't happen. But I'm just curious at how NIL can work with Pitt. Listen, Pitt's not a big program compared to the biggest programs in the country, but – it's not like we're some no-name scrub. Like, Pitt does have big-time donors and obviously a great tradition with the program, the sport. I mean, so many guys from the local area that have been Hall of Famers, not just college Hall of Famers, but professional, like in the pro Hall of Fame as well. I mean, there's got to be a lining in which you're like, okay, we need to figure out how we can keep these guys around, not just being successful, but also in the hyper-competitive world that is NIL, especially with especially in the ACC, you got to be competitive. Pitt should be one of the better programs in the ACC when it comes to football, I will say.
Yeah, and I think, so I will say, like, losing these guys, and I think, like, the kind of implication is not, like, the implication going around, I guess, is not just that Hayes thought the team was bad and he wanted to leave, but also that there was some money involved, like, that there was some money issues and that he felt like he wasn't getting what he was worth in terms of NIL and had to go somewhere else to find that. That very maybe well be true. We don't know that. But, I mean, I think the fact of the matter is that they were able to also convince Gavin Bartholomew to stay. And, I mean, obviously, like you said, your first point is exactly right. You never know with the transfer portal. But as of right now, they've been able to retain Gavin Bartholomew, Rodney Hammond, Kenny Johnson. I mean, I don't know if Yarnell was ever a portal candidate, but he stayed. You're able to get a guy to come from Alabama to Pittsburgh. And, you know, you're able to keep Mumfield and Reynolds and all these other guys. Like, there are a lot of starters on this team that were eligible to leave and came back. You know, McMillan, McIntyre, O'Brien. Like, there were guys here that could have left and didn't. So I don't think that Pitt's NIL efforts are completely in the toilet. I don't think they're, you know, that bad. So I wouldn't say I'm necessarily that concerned about them. Like you said, I mean, every team loses transfers in the offseason. And Pitt, I mean, even this season, like, I was stunned after last season how little they lost to the transfer portal. And you got to add in DeShields and Hayes to that. But, excuse me, I think that point still holds true, that more often than not, they have done better retaining guys than they have losing guys. That's just a simple fact. Like, Pitt has one of the lowest transfer rates of any team in college football. Generally speaking, they are able to do pretty well retaining guys. So I don't think this points to anything necessarily, you know, big picture, the program's falling apart in any way. They're huge. They're losses, certainly. But I think you can compartmentalize them a little bit too. These are losses for the 2024 season. And I'm not sure this says anything bigger that we didn't already know. I'll put it that. Like, I think you're right. Like, Pitt should be competitive in the ACC, should be one of the better programs in the ACC, both in football in terms of both in football and as it relates to what they can do with NIL. And it's all kind of dependent on what happens this season. I mean, if they're 3-9 again, then we're having a different conversation. But for right now, I don't see these as things that are going to meaningfully change the outcome of the 2024 season. Maybe they lose one more game than I would have projected them to otherwise, but I don't think that it. We said after the spring game that I think this is a bowl team, and I don't think these losses really change that at all, to be quite honest with you. So maybe I'm underrating what DeShields and Hayes were worth to this team, but again, like, I still do buy into the idea that losing guys from a 3-9 team isn't always the worst thing in the world. And I think Pitt's got enough to kind of cover for these losses and get back to where they are supposed to be, which is a perennial bowl team, you know, fighting for 7, 8, 9 wins just about every year. To wrap this video, I just want to ask you, I mean, after all these transfers, do you expect anyone else to? I mean, I know Pitt's got to get under the scholarship limit, so there's got to be some maneuvering there, but is there anywhere that you're looking at saying, yeah, the next transfer, the next guy who's headed out could come from here?
Well, two guys they put on scholarship last year as walk-ons, Nick Lappy at linebacker and Jake McConaughey at wide receiver. Maybe those guys are two players that the coaching staff says, hey, like, we appreciate what you've done, but I think you could succeed somewhere else. But, I mean, I don't know. Maybe one of the elder defensive linemen that hasn't really had a ton of production. But not sure. I think there's some guys that maybe like a Javonte Royal and his defensive back. I've never seen him play, really. I mean, he's been on special teams, but he's never played like cornerback or safety that I've seen of. So maybe him, maybe one of the wide receivers. Not sure who, but there's some guys that aren't playing at the moment. Maybe a running back as well. There's always a ton of running backs at Pitt. Don't expect any more quarterbacks to transfer. I think Deffenbach will stay at the third, and then Duggar will redshirt as he's incoming, obviously early enrollee as a freshman. So they'll be set there. So, yeah, maybe a wide receiver, running back, a defensive back, probably maybe another defensive lineman, maybe if they bring some more guys in, because it looks like they just offered an Arkansas State defensive end the other day. So it looks like not only do they need guys to depart from the program, but they'll be trying to bring players in. So a lot more transfers are coming, Steven. That's what all I can say.
Yeah, definitely. I think you're spot on. There are going to have to, just simply math reasons, there are going to be some more transfers. There's going to be some more player attrition. I think the offensive side of the ball is where I'm looking first. I mean, I'm looking at those three freshman receivers, not named Kenny Johnson, who came in last year, Israel Polk, Lamar Seymour, Zion Fowler. I just think that room is so crowded that one of those guys is just kind of going to get crowded out and just kind of say, hey, this room is so crowded, there's so many guys in front of me, I need to go find a different opportunity somewhere else. That kind of thing happens. I think the same thing at running back, just the way with bringing in Desmond Reed, adding Jewels Goff, who I'm really high on. I think you could look at, I mean, even like a Derek Davis, or I don't think Daniel Carter is going anywhere, but you know, or a Montrevious Lloyd. Like, those are guys who I could see conceivably leaving. I don't think there will be any heavy hitters headed to the portal. Like you said, I think most of their movement's going to kind of be on the periphery, both in terms of who they could add and who's going to head out. But I mean, again, I didn't see DeShields and Hayes leaving. So maybe I don't know much about who's headed to the portal and who's not, but we shall see. Appreciate y'all tuning in to another Inside Pitt Report. Thank you all for tuning in as we worked through these kind of disappointing and surprising transfers, but appreciate you all sticking with us. Make sure to like this video, subscribe to us on YouTube. That's youtube.com/InsideThePanthers, and follow all of our reporting, from the basketball and football off seasons and much, much more at si.com/college/Pittsburgh. Like I said, appreciate you all tuning in, and I will see you next time.